Four.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of The Grit. I do have a thing with my hair. There we go. I'm trying to fix. I had to wear a wig today. It's a long story, but it has to do with
the. It was usually on the weekends.
It's usually on the weekends, but today I had to wear one during work, and my hair has never been the same. Welcome to The Grit, everyone. We're so glad to have you here. RC is out. He'll be back,
probably next week.
Maybe. Probably next week. Sure. But in the meantime, we brought the beard in, pinch hitting for Mr. Arkansas, whatever his name is,
Rafael.
RC. Concepcion. Rafael is Mr. Brad Moore. Hello, Mr. Brad.
How's it going?
It's going well. How are things?
Things are good. I did not wear a wig today, so I'm doing okay.
Are you in the thing at all?
I don't think I am.
Oh, Brad might not make the movie that we're so. We always shoot a movie for the opening keynote at Photoshop World. And
I think I was supposed to be in the scene that they were going to film Friday, but that scene, I believe, got cut from the filming.
Oh, yeah.
Because okay. We're so, hard up against our deadline.
Yes, we're hard up against our deadline. That sounds really good. Anyway, whoa, it's almost like having RC here. Hey, today our topic is travel photography. We're going to be talking a whole bunch about travel. I just took a trip, and Brad was there. We went to London, England.
Mm-hmm.
That we did. Which is, as opposed to any other London, it's just London.
Not London, Kentucky. London, England.
Not London, Ontario. Just London. And I had a wonderful time. Had a great crowd, lots of fun.
Mm-hmm.
Had a little kind of gray weather. And then my family was with me, so we went down to Paris. My daughter's 9 years old. She's always wanted to go to Paris. And I asked her, I said, so, sweetie, why do you want to go? Do you want to see the Eiffel Tower? And she says, Daddy, I want to see everything. There you go. We saw everything. Everything. Now, but we're going to talk about all that stuff today. Hey, first of all, we have a winner. We do a photo challenge every week,
mm-hmm.
right, over at Kelby One.
Yep.
And so this week's winner was a photo called Water Drops on Flowers. It was from Teresa Pretzi. And that's a good shot.
Presti or Pretzi?
Pretzi.
Because we got two different spellings here. Presti. The watermark there says Presti.
Presti. So there we go. That's a beautiful shot.
Good job, Teresa.
So congratulations to her. And we have another challenge for you next week. And next week's is waterfalls?
Waterfalls.
All right, next week's is waterfalls.
There you go.
You know, can I tell you something? It's a little easier to shoot the flowers because there's a florist on every corner. You can go buy a flower, shoot mm-hmm. in your house, a little spray bottle of water. If you don't have a waterfall near your house, it makes it a little trickier.
Can't just go buy one of those. I guess you could buy a fountain.
All right, one more thing, and we're going to talk about travel. One more thing. This is really important. Do you live in San Francisco? Do you know someone that lives in San Francisco?
Are
you going to San Francisco? Anyway.
Pete's over to the side. He has
this is a really, really unique opportunity. Frank Duerhoff, who is just like the awesome, awesome mm-hmm. Lighting, the guy who wrote Mastering the Model Shoot, right? Frank mm-hmm. Duerhoff, Photoshop World instructor, super cool guy, is doing a workshop in San Francisco. And that is very, very rare, but if you want to go check it out, you can go to this link. It's a bit.ly link, so bit.ly/FrankNSF. So as in Frank in San Francisco. So bit.ly/FrankNSF, and you'll have all the details there. But if you get a chance to see Frank, I met a guy at my London seminar who had just been to one of Frank's. So Frank was in England while we were there, just teaching in a different area. And I said, so how was it? Because I already knew the answer. He's like, it was amazing. It blew my mind. It was great. That's the kind of day you're going to have. So go check it out. I'm very jealous if you get a chance to see Frank. I've learned so much from Frank. You will too. Go check him out. bit.ly/FrankNSF. Coming to San Francisco very soon.
Awesome.
All right. So here's what I did. I had a couple of plans of things that I wanted to shoot in London and in Paris.
And everything went perfectly according to plan. No snafus, no road bumps, no speed bumps, nothing.
I had a lot of planning. Everything went perfectly.
As it always does.
As it always does. Well, so one place I was trying to shoot really, really hard and could not make any contact with them was St. Paul's Cathedral in London. I had no idea how awesome that cathedral was. I really didn't. I saw a picture of it, and someone said, this is St. Paul's. I'm like, that's not St. Paul's. That looks more like, you know, the St. Peter's Basilica in Rome. And so I thought they just mismarked it. Because I'm just like on Pinterest or on 500px, I'm going to mismark it.
Sure.
It wasn't. That place is unbelievable. So I tried to find some connections and stuff, because what I learned was, through a friend of mine who lives in the U.K., you are not allowed to take any photographs in St. Paul's. You walk in the door and it's no photos, no photos, no photos, no photos. Now, I read on their website that it said in their press contacts, no photos or video. But I didn't realize the level of seriousness they were about this. They were dead. You walk in the door, the signs are everywhere.
Standing by with tasers.
So anyway, I wrote about this on my blog. Everywhere I went to try to shoot, I was turned away.
Right.
Not just you can't set up a tripod. It was like, no photos. For example, in London, I went to the City Hall. If you go to Google and type in London City Hall, you will see 5,000 photos inside of City Hall. They have a very cool, very modern City Hall. And so I went there. The public is invited. It's open. I go in. The security guards are really nice. We're talking. We're having a good time. I have all my gear. I go inside. I get to the one area where you want to shoot, and it's closed. And apparently, it is always closed. You can't get in there for anything. I talked to the security guards. I talked about, that room is closed. And it's an atrium with a circular thing that goes up that's amazing. But you would actually have to be like attending a talk there. It's an empty room. There's nothing in there. It's got some seats and an empty floor.
They wouldn't unlock it.
They were no. So I was very sad because, I read online. It says, it even tells you, like, come by. We got free wireless. Hang out in the City Hall. I mean, seriously, they do. And so maybe you can find some. That's the place. And, So can we go to, you connected to
I got to connect.
So go to, like, video control room two. I'm on one.
Okay.
All right. And so take a look. This Brad's going to show you, if you go on Google, there's a million shots of it. So there it is.
Yeah, I've seen the outside, but I have
right.
not been
there
inside.
There is no way to get in, to get down. See how down there is, like, yeah. I wanted to shoot either up high. Yeah, there's a million shots, none of these taken by Scott Kelby. There's
is
all
this,
kinds
is this
of,
it right here? Is that the room?
That's the room, but there was nothing like it. It was just empty. There was no seats. Like, that looks like a United Nations summit. There was nothing set up down there. And there was no one in there that would let me have. Look at that. There could really, some really cool shots could be made
that
there.
That is cool. Yeah.
And so I'm working on two books. They're both photo books. One is called The Great Indoors, which is classic, beautiful interiors. Mm-hmm. One is called Modern Love, and it's the ultra modern stuff. That's what I wanted that for.
Right.
No way. I went to St. Paul's. No way. I went into St. Paul's, had to go see it, and no way. And then, also, where else did I go? Everywhere I went, we looked into Westminster Abbey. Absolutely not. They're just like, no photos. What has happened? Like, seriously. Like, you can make a case for City Hall. Maybe they just don't want people in there taking pictures. But, like, I understand no flash. I totally understand no flash.
Right.
I don't understand no pictures. I don't understand any church. Like, you go to Rome to, like, St. Peter's Basilica, which has got to be the most amazing church or cathedral I've ever seen in my life. And I've seen a bazillion of them since I was a kid. Just amazing. And everyone's taking the pictures, and everybody's cool with it. And then you go to Westminster Abbey, no way. Here, no way. It's like, I don't know what's happened. It's really become a struggle. And so another guy was telling me while I was there, he goes, you put a tripod down someplace, you'll go berserk. Guy wrote on my Facebook page that he had put a tripod down and shot the outside of Parliament. So he's out on public, on a sidewalk, puts and takes a shot. And you got to realize, the Parliament building is where Big Ben is. This is like a touristy thing, right? It's Big Ben. It's Big Freaking Ben, right? You got this big place. And the guy said, four policemen stopped him, talked to him, questioned him about everything. His political affiliations, his religious affiliations, everything. What are you doing these images? Why are you taking them and all? And it's not a London thing. It's an everywhere thing.
Mm-hmm.
I'm really, really surprised. I don't know what it's about. But anyway, we went to London. I had zero luck there. I went to a very cool place. Went to the Lloyd's of London.
Went to really Lloyd's cool of London. Place.
And I'm going to show you some pictures from there. And it didn't go well for me.
You didn't go inside there either, did you?
I tried to go inside there, and they let me know I was not going inside there. They were very adamant about it. Let me. So here's the building. I actually stumbled upon this. I had a list. I had this list of places I wanted to shoot, and one of them was Lloyd's of London. And this is their building. It's super ultra modern, and it's just really, really cool.
Mm-hmm.
And so here's the thing. I wanted to go inside, so I went to the front thing, because one of their very, very famous One of their very, very famous pictures that you see everywhere is the interior of Lloyd's of London. It's like the City Hall. If you go to Google and type in Lloyd's of London. So anyway, I went to the front desk and said, I just want to come in and just take a picture. They're like, no. And I'm like, I can't even just go in and take like a picture, just like a picture of your lobby. It's like world famous. Everyone sees it. You've got 50,000 people working in this building. I'm sorry, there's not room for another. No. And they're like, do you know anybody in the building? I'm like, I know nobody. I get on my phone and start calling my buddies. Nobody knows anybody that works at Lloyd's in London. So.
Like that?
Yeah, here's a picture. Brad's going to show you the interior. Amazing place. Yeah. And that's just kind of an average picture of it. You can get amazing pictures of it. But anyway, yeah, look at that nice fisheye. Top left. Right? Oh, not top nope. left. Next one down. Sorry.
No.
That was. Yeah. It's a crazy place. So anyway. That's a Getty one, so you can buy it. You can buy this picture. You can license this picture. It's from Getty.
But it's not yours.
Somebody asked, have you shot Westminster Abbey? Sean Roberts?
Sean Roberts.
Sean Roberts?
Robertson.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Jeez. She was at the seminar.
Oh, okay. There we go. Have you shot Westminster Abbey? The answer at Westminster Abbey is no.
Westminster not even Abbey? Outside?
Oh, outside? Maybe outside, but I can shoot that from my car. So, all right, so you, streamer, 1054 says, Scott, you have to have Harpa in Iceland in your modern book. Trust me, Google it. All right, Brad's going to Google it. Hey, so what I want to show you, though, is so the images I just showed you. Can I show them again real quick? The images I just showed you. Here we go. These are HDR images, but they are processed only in Lightroom.
Okay.
So it's not the crazy... the crazy HDR, but I did this a lot. So I shot three exposures. Now I'm hand holding. So I'm standing outside. You can see it's kind of an overcast day.
Mm-hmm. What are you shooting with?
I'm shooting with, I was a really cool lens. So I got a Canon 1DX and my lens, and that's really, the lens is what did the magic here, is an 11-24, right?
It's a nice lens.
It's a wonderful lens. It's so wide. It's wide, like, but it's not a fisheye.
Right.
And it doesn't distort.
It's rectilinear.
It's rectilinear, which sounds naughty, and it is. All right, what I want to do is I want to show you how I made the HDRs.
Okay.
So if I can just, let me just bop over here too.
Do I see the gherkin in there too?
The gherkin is in there. So this building over here is referred to as the gherkin. I can't see it because we're not looking at my screen. There it is. This building over
looks
here,
like a big
the
egg.
Top right corner. The gherkin, known locally as the gherkin. You guys never remember me. You suck. Thank you. Hey, look, I'm not seeing a picture of you. I'm reading your name off a screen. It doesn't show your picture. It's just a name. But, you know, the you suck part's nice. Thank you. Okay, anyway. So, all right. So I want to show you, here are the three shots. So we have three shots. This is the two stops underexposed. Normal exposure. So that's what it kind of really looked like when I was standing there. And two stops overexposed. So three shots. I only shoot three. I just go click, click, click.
Right.
I switch my camera to high speed mode to where I only have to press and hold the shutter button once. It goes click, click, click. Well, it doesn't really matter. But anyway, because you could do it individually.
It keeps you from moving in between shots.
Right. That's what's nice about it being fast is because I'm not on a tripod. Doesn't matter, doesn't make a lick of difference if you're not on a tripod, but
right.
I'm hand-holding. So one, two, three, we take the three images, we go photo merge, and just choose HDR. Now, watch how quick this is. I mean, it's not like 2 seconds, but it brings up this creating HDR preview window. And look, I say it goes quick and it's not going super quick, but generally it takes about 11 seconds. Now, these are high resolution images from a 1DX. Now, I want to just talk to you about what's going on over here. Auto align. I leave auto align turned on. It's done. You can we switch back? There we go. Auto align. I leave auto align turned on if I'm not on a tripod, and I was not on a tripod.
Right.
Right. So that's number one. Number two is auto tone. This basically kind of gives you an auto adjustment of the image. And it, in my case, I think it always looks better on. I don't ever turn it off. Can I show you what it looks like when you turn it off? Bleh.
Ew.
Just kind of looks like the normal image.
Yeah.
this looks like more like an HDR. Look at the depth.
But not
and
crazy
the
over the top.
But not crazy over the top at all. So right now we're just kind of at go, right? Now, you have deghosting amounts. If you see movement in there, if one of those buildings moved, we'd have a whole different issue. So in this case, all I'm gonna do is just, all I do is open it and I look at it. If it's okay, I hit merge. So now it merges pretty quick. It's almost done. You can see the status bar in the top left corner.
Within 9 to 11 minutes.
All right, and then it's done. And it is the one, and what's interesting, when it makes the image, it is a DNG. Here, let me see if you can see the file name. I don't know why you can't see my file name. So. Yeah, that's actually a DNG right there. So it still retains the properties of like a raw image. So let's go to the develop module. Let's hide this other junk over here. And look, we have a black screen. That's interesting.
It's a beautiful black screen.
Oh, that's pretty bad, really.
Four stops underexposing.
Dude, it's nothing. There's nothing there.
What did you do?
I don't know. I've never seen that
before.
Hey,
can we blame Arnaldo?
I always blame him. Well, look, there's the thumbnail. There's the image. Okay, it's...
Give it another try.
Go to the develop module, and it turns black.
Awesome. You left it in the fixer too long.
I'm going to quit Lightroom.
Nice.
And we'll relaunch it in just a moment. Here we go. Luckily, it launches really fast. There's the splash screen, and that's really weird. Now...
I'm reading the questions while you're doing that.
Oh, yeah, read the questions.
Scott, I'm heading to Paris in September. Would an 18 to 200, 3.5 to 6.3 be sufficient for travel photography?
Absolutely. I love the... So you have a crop sensor camera. I think the 18 to 200 is awesome for travel photography. Yeah. I would just take that one lens. If I could get away with one lens, I really try to.
And especially if you're mostly going to be shooting in the day, and even at night on a tripod.
Oh, yeah. The 18-200 is awesome for travel photography. I've done many, many, many of my trips with that exact lens. All right. We're in the develop module. Now it's working. So
there we go.
How do you fix any program?
Restart.
Quit it and restart it. All right. Here we go. So this is what I did. So you have to realize, I took the three images and put them into one. Take a look at the develop module. Do you see the slides? The sliders are all already moved for you.
Ooh.
That's kind of the auto thing, right?
Fancy.
So now I just have to decide what I would do. Well, if I look at the image, I can tell you the things that I think are wrong. I don't see enough detail in here. I don't see enough detail in here. I don't see enough detail in here. But since these are landscape shots, over here I like to go to clarity. Clarity actually enhances texture.
They should just call it the magical slider.
They should call it the magical slider. It enhances texture, and it kind of... especially for things with a lot of edges, it really enhances the detail.
Right.
I would say if you want more detail in your shots. So watch, I'm going to increase it a bit. Now, notice how some of those areas just got brighter.
Mm-hmm.
So we're going to increase that. I'm also going to open up the shadows a bit more. Now, sometimes when you open up the shadows a lot, it starts to look weird. But because this is an HDR image, it is much more, it's much less forgiving.
More forgiving.
Much more forgiving when you open up the shadows. You don't see noise as
right.
much. On a regular photo, if you open up the shadows a lot, you'll
yeah,
see noise. But the way they're doing this HDR image, you can actually open up the shadows a lot more without seeing the noise. So I'm going to crank up the shadows a bit more. And it helped a little. Now, at this point, there's not a tremendous amount left to do. What I did do to the other photo and what I would do to this is, there's one part I don't really like, and it's the sky. The sky is pretty flat. So I'll darken it, the whole image, a little bit, and I'll increase the contrast a lot, which I generally do. All right, so we're getting close to what the final image was, but now I'm gonna go fix the sky. I'm gonna go up here and get the adjustment brush. And I'm gonna double click on the word effect. When you double click on the word effect, it resets, right? Resets all the sliders to zero, and we're gonna darken the sky. Now I have a tip for you about how to use this brush. First, make sure you have turned off auto mask. You want auto mask off. And then you wanna paint over most of the sky and stay away from the edges of stuff. So you wanna paint over all this. Look how fast your brush goes with auto mask turned off. Just don't get near the edges of anything. Once you've got most of it painted in, all right, because here's why I'm having you turn it off. When it's on, Lightroom is constantly doing math. It's trying to find out where the edges of things are.
Mm-hmm.
So the mathematics is going on the whole time in the background. When you turn it turns off the math. Now you're just painting and your brush goes really fast. But when you get near the edges and you're afraid that you're gonna paint over something, that's when you turn it on. So I'm gonna turn on auto mask now. I go up to the edges. and it doesn't paint over the building. It senses where the edges are, and it does a really good job.
Because if you're not careful, you can get that kind of glowy look around the buildings, and you don't want that.
Now, let's point out something while we're here. Do you see these two splotches, maybe three splotches or four splotches,
right in the middle of the images? I don't know what those could
be. Now, Brad is thinking, it's sensor dust. I'm about to give him some junk. It was actually raining on me.
Good. So, I mean, that's terrible.
Now, luckily, while I was shooting a couple of times, I actually stopped and wiped the rain away. I carry like a cleaning cloth with me in my wallet, so I pulled it out. So that's why here we're going to go fix them the old-fashioned way. But those are not, because every time I have sensor dust, Brad starts to go, uh-oh.
I understand camera cleaning is necessary, but I don't like to do it just because sometimes you get in there and end up smearing more than you're cleaning.
Yes, so it's very bad. If you spilled over any, you can always hold the option key. I spilled over a little bit on this area right there. But okay, so look how much different the sky looks now. So watch the sky. So I'm darkening it down. I think that helps the overall image. And you can also increase the contrast or even add a little clarity while you're there just by moving those sliders. So lastly, I thought the gherkin, as Brad called it, the gherkin.
That's what it's called.
I thought the gherkin was a little dark. So I went to the brush again. I double-clicked on effect, and I made sure I clicked on the button new. So it doesn't affect what I've already done. It allows me to do something new. And I painted over the gherkin. Working the gherkin, as Pete just called it, which really sounds unfortunate. And then these three areas that I pointed out that were a little dark, we're going to go and lighten them up as well. So that's what I did. Now you can see there's still a couple of spots that need to be fixed. I can go in here with the spot removal tool, just click and get rid of those. But those are literally rain. They're not sensor dust because it was raining. Okay, so here's the thing. This is the interesting thing. I'm going to do another photo if I can. But do you mind? I'm going to do it real quick.
You may.
Because I want to tell you something weird about the HDR thing. And I think it's important to note. I'm going to look at three images taken in Paris. These images are taken inside of the most amazing department store ever, Galeries Lafayette. By the way, here's a little travel tip. So when you're at Galeries Lafayette, which is honestly, it's unbelievable, like seven stories, amazing. It looks like a palace, and they added, you know, clothes to it later. On the ladies' side is where you want to go. The men's side, they're like, who cares? The ladies' side's fabulous. On the roof of Galeries Lafayette, on the roof, is a free observatory overlooking Paris. You can see the Eiffel Tower clearly. You can see the rooftops, the whole skyline. It's almost a 360 view. You can see all the way from the Sacré-Cœur over to, it's unbelievable. It's free. There's all kinds of seating up there, and there's never, ever any kind of seating.
Right.
There's seating, there's a coffee shop. You can get coffee, you can get ice cream, you can get all kinds of stuff. It's really, really nice, completely free on the roof of Galeries Lafayette. So I'm inside shooting, and here's the thing I wanna show you. When you make an HDR, and this is, you might find this interesting, it's creating a preview. And by the way, that's why it's pretty quick about when it first shows you the image. Because if you use like Photomatix or any of the other images, it takes a long time to create an HDR. It's quite a time. It's much, much quicker here in, of course I say that and it's going slow. Why is my machine, okay, it's almost done. All right, there we go.
There it is.
So I want you to see something. Here it is, I'm just gonna click merge. Just, here's why. And it does merge really quickly. Okay, because when we're done, and this is what I was gonna tell you, it's so sharp, the 16-bit HDR, that I usually don't sharpen it. Wow. So let me show you. I don't.
Because you sharpen everything.
I know, but it's so.
But not this.
Look at the detail and stuff.
Crispy.
Wait till it draws, because it's a really large photo. It's so crispy. Now, I haven't done anything to it. This is like the raw shot out of the camera. I would add clarity and things. In fact, well, I'll just show you what I would do just real super quick. I would add some contrast and some clarity, right? And then once you've done these things, and open up the shadows a little bit, I mean, it is so. I'll go to full screen here. It's so crisp that you're like, you're gonna sharpen this now? If I do sharpen it, I apply just a tiny little bit of sharpening.
Well, especially if you're gonna print it.
Well, yeah, if you're gonna print it, that's different, but most of our images are shared on the web now. But I mean, everything is so sharp and so crisp that you're like, I don't know if I really should sharpen it. Mm-hmm. And when you sharpen it, you look at it, you go, ah! Hey, so we had somebody ask a question here. They wanted to know how much the 11 to 24 is.
Yep. I've got that right here.
It is not an inexpensive lens. It is a magical lens, but anything magical costs $2,999 over at B&H is where I get or this stuff.
Or if it's something that you're not going to be using all the time, you can go rent it. You can get
you could rent it.
Lens Pro to Go or the other one, Borrow Lenses.
Borrowlenses.com. Yeah. So either one of those, you could rent it from there. But it's an amazing lens. It is kind of heavy.
Mm-hmm.
But it's sharp. It's sharp all the way to the edges. It's I would say as wide angle lenses go, it's my all time favorite wide angle lens.
And we only have the one right now. So because you had that, while I was out walking around shooting, I was shooting with this guy. Canon G7X.
Brad was shooting with a baby.
But
baby lens.
I mean, I could have grabbed another camera and lens and gone out and been fine. But honestly, I didn't want to be having a 10-pound brick on my shoulder walking around all day. So just having this guy with me and
how many megapixels?
I like how I'm talking. It's a close up of you. I don't know how many megapixels it is.
It's a bunch of megapixels though.
18
megapixels?
Yeah. So and it shoots raw.
I bet it's.
But I don't want to get too much into it right now because we probably need to go take a quick break.
Yeah, we should.
And we'll talk about it when we come back. But yeah.
Yeah, so. We're gonna talk. I got some more travel stuff to show you. When we get back, I'm gonna kind of take you through the shoot real quick because I did a post over at Exposure. I'll show you the shots, the final shots that I got, and then we'll talk about some more. I got some more Lightroom stuff to show you.
Cool.
And just other just dumb stuff and some tips. And we have more of your questions too. We'll talk about all of that when, Brad?
When we come right back from this break.
Award-winning photojournalist Joe McNally, Dave Black, Olympic sports photographer, decorated combat photographer Stacy Pearsall, nationally recognized portrait and wedding photographer Roberto Valenzuela. Just a few of the amazing instructors you'll interact with when you attend Photoshop World in Las Vegas. Hands-on training with the best in photography and design. Learn more in 3 days than you have in 3 years. Photoshop World. Be with the best.
Hey guys, my name is Peter Hurley, and I just did a new class on KelbyWan.com called The Art of the Edit. What is editing about? Do you shoot people? Let's say we do some amazing headshots and we do an amazing session. What do we have to do? We have to narrow that sucker down to the best shots. How do you pick the best headshot from all these pictures? Why am I picking this shot over this shot, or that shot over that shot, or that shot over that shot? Which one is she gonna use? How are we gonna know? This is my editing process. I'm gonna pull out the shots that are the real winners out of there. I am looking for that elusive shebang shot. A shebang has lookability. It has something that makes me feel something inside. We're gonna develop an eye for this. I'm gonna show you how it's done. I'm gonna show you how I do it. You have to find your own shebangs. Develop this muscle. The Art of the Edit, exclusively on KelbyWooden.com. Shebang!
Hey, we're back here at the Grid, and we forgot to mention our giveaways. So today, at the end of the show, we'll tell you how you can win these. Today, we're giving away Album Moxie by Kara Pelkonic. Where's it at? There.
Album Moxie, it's a book.
From Austin, Kansas by Vincent Versace. So watch till the end, and you will find out how you can enter to win these books.
There you go. At the end. And also, we'll give away two tickets to, a ticket. We'll give one ticket to two different people to my upcoming seminar. I have no idea where it is.
Phoenix.
It's in Phoenix?
Yeah.
When is it?
9/22.
September 22nd? I got all of August off. Whee!
Because we're going to Vegas.
Oh, yeah, we're going to Photoshop World. I don't really have it off. Okay, but so I'm going to be in Phoenix, Arizona.
Here you go.
Hey, we got to shoot a car when we're out there. Okay, we're in Phoenix in September. Oh, there we go. And then we're in Austin, Texas. I haven't been to Austin in years. I'm looking forward to that a lot. I love Austin. It's a great, great town. Then I'm going to be in San Francisco, Chicago, Livonia, Tampa.
That's a long way away.
D.C., yeah. All right, so anyway, that's all coming up. Okay, we had some questions. Somebody asked, is there a comparable Nikon lens to the Canon 11-24? I think the closest would be the Nikon 14-24.
Until the 11-24 was released, the Nikon 14-24 was my favorite lens.
Yeah, I used to like that lens.
So wide.
Yeah,
love it.
It's wide, but 14 is wide.
But 11's wider.
But 11's wider. anyway, that's probably the most comparable one from Nikon.
For sure.
Okay, some more questions. What are some good lenses for travel? TK Photography asked this. I can tell you, so when I'm thinking travel, I'm thinking I want lightweight. I don't want to be carrying something heavy. And here's the key thing. I don't want to carry around a bunch of lenses. Now, I brought this 11-24. It's not mine. I don't own it. It's a loaner. So Canon is going to take it back from me. But they were nice enough to let me use it because they said, you know, I'm doing some things. Can you loan it to me? I was supposed to send it back right before Paris. And I was like, can I keep it another week? And I'm like, oh, okay. So anyway, I've lost any friends I had there by borrowing stuff. But so... I tell you what's a really good one, and I had it with me. I used it quite a bit. Is the 28-300 Tamron.
Mm-hmm.
Now, so Canon makes a 28-300. It is an absolutely outstanding lens. It's just very big and heavy.
Yeah.
So the Tamron is not nearly as good a lens, quite frankly. It's not as sharp. It's not, but it's lightweight and
it's like
it goes
this big.
Yeah, it's very small, and it goes 28-300. For full frame, that's a full frame lens. It's equivalent to the 18-200,
which on was a crop, before.
Which is mentioned before, right. On a crop sensor lens. So that would be now. Nikon also makes the 28-300, and theirs is lightweight and small and low priced. It's actually quite a good lens. So if you're a Nikon shooter, get Nikon's own.
Right.
If you're a Canon shooter. The 28-300 that Canon makes is good, but it's 3.7 pounds.
Yeah, it's heavy.
Really good, but it's really heavy. And I think that what it is, and I'm hoping this is coming from Canon, I'd love to see Canon make a lightweight 28-300. That would be the next lens I bought. I've been waiting forever for the 11-24 because you think you want to know before stuff is released, but you don't. Because I knew like months and months before the 11-24 was coming out. And so I couldn't wait to get it. It was driving me nuts. I was like, oh, that's the, of all lenses I want, you know. Anyway, so I'm going to get on a waiting list. They have a wait. I think B&H has a waiting list, right?
Sure.
I've got to get that lens now. So I'm sending the loaner back. I'm going to have to buy one. Okay, on to our story. So someone said, Tom MM asked, do you prefer two stops over and under, or one stop over and over? You know what? To get the range that you need, HDR really requires two stops. Now, on my particular, because you won't get the results that you want off of one stop. You just won't. The results that you want of that big, big range, one stop either way ain't going to get you there. So I think if you read any book on HDR, any tutorials, they're all going to tell you a minimum of two stops. Now, on my Canon, I can just say, do two stops. It's really easy. There's a little button on the back. You hit Q, go to two stops. It's a no-brainer. On Nikon, like when I was shooting Nikon, I had to take five photos and I would throw two of them away. But can I?
Depending on the model.
Depending on the model, because it was weird. It was the D800, which is the one that you really needed to have two stops, wouldn't do it. But then the D4 would. So yeah, depending on the model. But I would say the vast majority of Nikons. I haven't shot them in 2 years, but the last time I shot them, the vast majority required you to take five shots, but you'd only. But here's the breaking Lightroom news. Ready? Lightroom works best if you only use the darkest shot and the brightest shot, and you don't use the normal exposure. You do not need the normal exposure to make an HDR. It will pull everything. I know. Got it straight from the Lightroom engineers. It works best. If you just use, or it's not necessary at all to use the other one. Now, if you're processing two images versus three, it's probably faster.
Sure.
You don't even need the normal image. Two darker, two lighter, it'll do the rest. Just two images. Dun, dun, dun. That was pretty, dramatic.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I want to show you some images from the trip. So let me get them ready here. Hold on. Oh wait, I did something bad. I just so hit the
Do you need some assistance working your computer?
Yeah, I probably do actually. Oh, one second. There we go. Here we go. So this is over on exposure.co, which is where I do my photo storytelling. And I'll just move this out a little bit. Here we go. So this is, now this shot, I got to tell you, I totally ripped this idea off. Totally. So my friend Dave Williams, who is our buddy, he's with Hybrid Photography in the UK. Very good photographer, really cool guy. Anyway,
yeah, I guess.
He sent me a bunch of ideas like, hey, I've been to Paris a lot. Here's where to go. And he had this picture. I wrote back. I said, I really like the one with the telescope. Now, I didn't shoot it from the same location. I believe his was shot from the Arc de Triomphe.
Could be.
The Arc de Triomphe. This was shot actually from Galeries Lafayette. This is the view from the top of the department store. Anyway, I saw it, I stole it, and then as soon as I took I stole the picture, I took a picture of the back of my camera and sent it to him with boom, I stole your shot. Okay, so that's there. All right, so here we go. Here is the shot that I really wanted to get, which is the Paris Opera House. I wanted to get this shot in such a meaningful way. The reason why is because I went there 3 years ago. I was teaching a class on travel photography. Went there 3 years ago and I forgot my lens. I needed to go really wide and I did not have a wide lens with me. I tried to do a pano and it came out so badly that I did a tutorial for Kelby One called My Paris Pano Disaster. That's how bad it was. So I wanted the chance to go back and do it right. And this is using a Canon 8 to 15 millimeter ready fisheye.
Was I with you for this?
You were with me for the first bad one. You weren't with me for this one.
Okay.
That's Paris. Were you in Paris?
I was in Paris. The
you were in Paris 3 years ago. This is like 3 days ago.
No, I'm saying the first one.
You were with me in the first one.
I don't remember the first one. Okay.
Did you go to the Opera House?
I don't think I did.
Brad might not have. Brad spent a lot of time in bars when we were there.
Yeah.
So anyway, but this is... So let me tell you what was a challenge about this. The big challenge was... You cannot imagine how many people are in this opera house on a daily basis. I have an example for you, if I can just jump over to Lightroom real quick. One of the problems was that people are doing tours, right?
Mm-hmm.
And they run tours, which is nice.
Stupid tourists. Get in
but anyway, yeah, they got all in your pictures. So take a look at this right here, if I can. So the problem is these folks in the seats right there are all kinds of tourists. There's a tour guide standing up talking. There's the other tourists over here. So I talked about this quite a bit on my blog this week when I did this, and in that story from Exposure, and that is what the secret of these shoots are, is patience and luck. Because what would happen is I would sit there. So there's this little tiny box. Can we go back? I'm going to go back to Exposure real quick. Can you look in here, right? So. See these little tiny box? See that little tiny box right mm-hmm. over here? Tiny box. That's exactly how much space they let 35 tourists in. So you are jammed up against the person next to you. And the first time I tried to shoot, literally people are knocking into me as I'm holding my exposure and all. It was really bad. This time I just said, I'm going to stay and be patient as long as I need to be. I kind of found a little spot. There is a wall in front of you. I put my camera down and I just waited until I wasn't getting jostled. But then I have two tour groups in front of me.
Right.
You know what would happen? One tour group would get up and leave. And I'm like, ooh, I can't wait till the other one leaves. The other one would start to leave and a new tour group would come in. So I just had to wait until there was that break where all of a sudden for a few minutes, and it was maybe 5 minutes, I was hoping it'd be just even if I had a minute, for 5 minutes, there was nobody mm-hmm. in there. So that's what it took, was basically waiting until that moment when there's nobody in there and you take the shot. So now what about, so if you look at the theater, there are, where I'm standing, I'm in one of the booths and then there's the other booth right here where my little finger cursor is. How come you don't see people in that one? Because I cloned this square over the tourists in this square.
Cheater.
It was the only thing I did that was like Photoshop-y to this, you know, the rest was easy. It's Lightroom and the HDR thing, right? But yeah, from there to there. Okay, so that was that. And then here in the next one, this is another one of those things where patience really pays off. So this was taken also in the Opera House. It looks like the Hall of Mirrors at Versailles.
Yeah, it took me a second when I first saw it.
That is actually literally just outside the theater. That's part of the, there's a balcony to your right you can walk out and take shots of. But here's the weird thing that happened here is it's so full of people, there's no way to get it with no people. There's mm-hmm. just so many. Now, I tried a trick that I taught on my last tour where you take one shot every 10 to 15 seconds and then you try to have Photoshop put it together. I shot that, but here's what I did. I knew that the last tour was at 5:30 and they literally throw you out at 6. Like at 6, they just go, time to go, time to go. I just waited in this room until 6:05, until they literally came. And so what was weird is some people were standing there. I'm like, come on, leave, leave. I'm standing there and they're standing there. I'm just waiting and waiting, waiting. And finally, the security guard, it was a woman. She comes and she's like, you know, Monsieur, it's time to go. I will kill you. So anyway, I'm like, okay. And I'm like waiting there. And she turns and she's talking to somebody else. And she looks back, just, Monsieur. And I yelled back, Beaujolais. No, I,
fromage.
La fromage. So here's the thing. I looked at her. And so I'm holding my camera. Can I have your camera? It was a bigger camera than this. I was like, please, camera. I looked at her and I was like, just one. Because this was the moment where there was nobody left in there. It was at closing. I smiled and went, just one, please. And she went, okay, one. So I went, click. Well, no, it was bracketed. No, this wasn't bracketed. I didn't have bracketing turned on. I just went, click, click, click. And that was it, because I didn't want to, she gave me a shot to do it. I didn't want to, you know. But I also, I'm hand-holding, the light's fairly low, and I didn't want to take one, and it was a little out of focus, a little sharp. So one of the tricks that I'll do in low light is to take multiple pictures, is to go click, 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 click. Chances are one of those is going to be tack sharp. The first one might be soft, the next one might be a little sharper, but one of those, if you shoot four or five shots, one of them is going to be very, very, very sharp and clear. So that's a little, because somebody asked the question right here. Where was it?
Have you got any trips?
So Fran, we know Fran.
Yeah, she was at the seminar.
Fran. Thank you. Fran did a write-up of my London seminar. Like she wrote like her experience of the day and all, and I met her and we talked numerous times during the day. Very, very nice person. And by the way, when I was looking at her her story, I looked at some of her images. She's a very good photographer as well. So anyway, thank you, Fran, for that. So Fran asks, do you have any tips for travel photography in day and night without a tripod? So my tip, or there's two tips. Tip number one is to take multiple shots. Just go, even if it's going click, click, click.
But preferably not doing this.
Don't move your head. But you know what I mean? Like where it goes click and the shutters open and then click and all. Just take a bunch of shots and chances are one will be other. Mm-hmm. But the way I got that shot of the opera, because it was very dark in there. It looks bright, but it was very dark. Was literally I took my camera and I leaned it on something. Now, of course, when you stick it on there, it's aiming not where you want. So you know what the trick was? I took my phone and used it as a prop. And I actually stuck the phone under it. So the lens would lean up and just kind of, and you know what it was? Here's the thing. I'm not a super patient person, but I thought, I 3 years it's been since I was in Paris, and 3 years it's been haunting me that I screwed up so badly. I was just going to do whatever. In fact, I was there with my wife and kids. We took the tour, went around the whole place, and then they were waiting for me outside of the opera. And I said, guys, she goes, we want to go back to the hotel and take a nap. Are you ready to go? I go, you're going to take a nap? Tell you what, you go and I will finish up here. And so they went back to the hotel, took a little nap because we wanted to go out again that night. They all went back, my daughter, my son, and my wife all went back, and I stayed until closing. So anyway, I had plenty of time, tipped it up, and got the shot. So in this case, that's what happened. Now, you can't see her because she actually walked out of the frame, but she was about halfway down there, angry French woman, but she was nice. Now that we're closed and they're hustling me out, I run downstairs because I wanted to get a shot right here. Now, there's not people in the shot. Those are mannequins wearing French costumes from the period. And that's new. That was been added since the last time I was there. The costumes are beautiful. It's actually very nice. But I cannot tell you how many people were on these stairs. It was like Grand Central Station. In fact, I did a little video. I won't play it here, but I showed a video. I just had to take a video to go, this is what, see that picture right there? Picture that for 3 hours. That's how long I was there. For 3 hours, it was I would sit there for 15 or 20 minutes just waiting for a little break. No break came. So I did try that little trick, you know, where you take multiple shots. So I did have a backup plan. But since she let me shoot here, right, I went straight downstairs, and got this shot. Now, this different security guard, I kind of stayed back. I was the last person walking out, but some guy was started taking pictures and walking into the frame. And so the security guard turned and started messing with him, and I got this shot. But I said, can I get one more? No. How about if I get behind this rope? No. He was really very insistent that I was done shooting. I got that shot from up on the second level, and I ran down real quickly and then got this shot. This is where he was doing the yelling, actually, down here. But it's, you can't believe how hard it is to get. The only time you're going to get this shot is maybe if you're the first person in the door in the morning or the last person out at the night, because it is absolutely jam-packed. And there is no putting up a tripod. It says no tripods as you go in. And son of a gun, if I didn't see a guy setting up a tripod, nobody said anything. All right. So that was that. Here's this. And here's the outside. Later in the day, I went back. It's not the right time to shoot it. Look at all the people. I still waited until there were no cars in front. I just stood across the street, waited till there were no cars. But that's the 11 millimeter.
That's nice.
Now, I had somebody ask me on Facebook, well, what do you think about the way the buildings are leaning back? I mean, wouldn't you correct that? No. Now, there's been times that I will.
If you were shooting architecture photography for
a client,
then yeah, you would want to correct that. But
I would still show the client them, because you know what? I love the way that looks leaning back. And I have done
it's
that
an artistic choice.
It is. I have done that correction, and most people chose, every time I showed both, most people by far chose the leaning back version over what you would call the correct version. I think it just looks better. And so sometimes you will see that. But I have had ones that I absolutely corrected because it looked funky. Like I shot the Taj Mahal and it looked just weird for whatever reason. All right. So that's one thing. So I love to go super wide, especially on like travel stuff. So the 28 is wide. But if you're going to take a second lens, and I don't like taking a second lens, but if you're going to take a second lens, you can go a little wider. How much time are we in? Oh, gosh, we're kind of
crazy. We got to take another break.
Yeah. Well, we'll take a break, and we're going to talk about it. I'm going to show you some more shots. We're going to talk about some. I have some more travel photography tips and advice coming up here in just a minute. We got some giveaways, and Brad's going to take you to the break.
Hey, let's go to break. Bye.
God, that was good. Really?
Space at squarespace.com.
Hi, I'm UK photographer Glyn Jewis, and I really hope you'll come check out my brand new class, Shooting Muscular Sports Physiques, only on kelby1.com. Now in this class, we're going to be on location in a real life boxing gym, and I'm not just going to show you multiple lighting setups, but I'm also going to show you how I can get the most out of each of those setups to get a variety of different shots. Now we're going to be photoing a couple of kickboxers who've already got muscular physiques, but I want to show you just a couple of simple tips and tricks that'll take a great muscular physique and make it look fantastic all on location. So come and check out my brand new class only on kelby1.com.
Welcome back to The Grid. We're here with Scott Kelby and myself, Brad Moore, talking about travel photography. Scott and I just went to London recently, and then
Swinging
he went on
London.
To Paris, and we're talking about pictures and give him photo tips and all sorts of fun
stuff.
Hey,
can we show something? Brad was just slinging this Canon. You didn't take any other camera? This is it?
I mean, I had the whole camera bag with me, but I was just like, you know what? If I'm going to be walking around all day, I don't really know how long we're going to be gone. I don't have to carry a bunch of crap with me. And
so you know what this really is? This is your second camera.
Yeah.
So this doesn't replace your DSLR, but I think if you want like a serious second camera, because this thing lets you shoot in manual mode.
It's
it
raw.
Lets you shoot raw. It does all kinds. It's got enough mega. I think it's more than 18.
It's 20.2.
Oh, it's 20.2.
I
20.2
it up,
megapixels. So, but Brad got some really nice. Now, I've never known you to do architecture shots, but I got to tell you, I loved your architectural stuff.
Yeah.
Can you show us?
Sure. Yeah, it's there ready to
Are
show.
Are you on the video control room too?
Just waiting on Arnaldo. yeah, so this was just walking around Debbie that works the seminars and Jeff Leinbach that also works We were all just walking around for the day, and Jeff was taking architecture stuff. And I, if you want to come back to the camera, I actually took this with me, but I literally just had it in my back pocket because I lost the little like wrist strap thing that comes with it. So I just had it in my back pocket, and whenever we would stop to take pictures, I'd be like, done. You know, it's just fast and easy. And I love, one of the things I do love about it is you can do like a touch focus on the back screen. It's kind of cool. So anyway, this was, we started off kind of by the, actually we went to the design museum, which is really cool. And then we went left from there, walked down the Thames, down by the Tower Bridge.
It's
and
pronounced
then,
Thames.
And then by City Hall. And this was just past City Hall, just some architecture that was there.
So you went to, you saw City Hall?
Yeah, we saw it.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's cool.
If you should, you told me you got inside, it'd be instant death.
I didn't go inside, no. And then just...
That would have gone badly for you. Do you really know a guy? Pete goes, I know a guy. And like,
just kind of playing with the lines and shadows and light, curve.
Oh, I like that. Yeah, dude, you did great.
And then this, Lloyds should, of London. This should look familiar.
Did they let you inside?
No, it didn't. Well, I didn't really try to go inside. And then I forget what that other building is.
That's the building...
There's the Gherkin.
That's the Gherkin.
The Gherkin.
It's Gherkin.
So, yeah.
All right, so let's see. Johan Stoop asks, when you travel, do you know in front on a particular location you're going to shoot HDR, or do you spot it when you're there? So I would say this, Johan. I'm going to shoot HDR anytime I see a wide range of light, or I see something with a lot of potential for detail, mm-hmm. right? So, because you know what it is about HDR is... Half the battle is knowing which shots make a good HDR.
Right.
So look at the things that I've shown so far that are HDR. I did the interior of the, you know, the very ornate interior inside churches, inside outside buildings and things that are like, if there's a puppy there, I'm not going to shoot an HDR.
Well, but you shouldn't shoot puppies in general.
No, you shouldn't shoot puppies at all. But you have to think about that. You've got to. You really have to think about, is there a wide range? Because if it's just kind of a regular old shot and you don't have really bright areas and really dark areas, HDR is not going to really help you.
Yeah.
So, and every time you take a shot, it's three raw shots. So it eats up your cards faster and stuff like that. So in general, I'm going to shoot it when I need it. Does that help? Like I'm going to shoot.
Yeah. Well, the other thing that I think a lot of people, the trap that people fall into with HDR is, they do it just to do HDR, not to make it a better shot. And a lot of times I see HDR pictures that are just, it's just a scene, but there's no real subject.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, they're thinking about the effect and not the photo.
Right.
Right, they're just like, I'm going to apply
it doesn't
this
need
effect.
To be a crutch. Right. It needs to be an enhancement of what's already
they're
there.
Also assuming that HDR would give them more rescue. They don't have to think about the shot.
Pete's saying that... Right. People will think that shooting HDR gives them more room to be rescued, so they're not really thinking about the shot as much. Anyway.
Right. Okay, so a couple more questions. So, Iggledot, hey, I know this guy. John, his name's John. So he was at my seminar. I talked to him at the end of the day, and he's a sports photographer. He shoots rugby. That dude shoots lights out. He brought me like a printed piece that he had done for shooting like for a rugby club. And and he was like, well, it's not U.S. football. And, but I mean, it was just awesome sports photography. I even had to ask him, did you do all these? You shot this shot. You know, I mean, he was really, really good. I was really, really impressed. And because sometimes people say, hey, can I show my sports photography? And I'm like, oh, well, but his stuff
that's
was
sports, all right.
His stuff was lights out, really, really good. Okay, a couple more things.
He wanted to know what photomechanic is.
Oh, what is photomechanic? Is it a good thing? What does it do? Okay, so interesting that you ask this.
Because I showed my pictures and photomechanic.
It's a program that's pretty much for sports photographers.
It's for photojournalists.
It is. It doesn't do any processing. So the stuff that you've seen me do, like in developing and all, right. doesn't do that. It is an awesome, awesome, insanely fast photo viewer.
Yes.
So a lot of times what we'll do is we'll use it real quick to find the images that we want and then drag those into Lightroom to do everything else.
Yeah.
Because it's so, so much faster than Lightroom.
If you're used to using Lightroom or Bridge, if you're going full screen and you're going image by image trying to tag what your selects are or get rid of the rejects or whatever.
Right, yeah.
Photo Mechanic does it like this.
Full screen as fast as you hit the button.
Lightroom, it's like
loading. Loading.
And when you're on deadline at a sporting event or whatever, like you need that speed. Right. So yeah, that's what Photo Mechanic is.
Ustreamer asks, says, Scott, I've got a trip planned in May for London, Paris, Italy, and Switzerland. You dog, so jealous.
Can we come?
Can you list off a few must-see spots for London and Paris other than the obvious ones? So here's what I would tell you, actually. I did a class called Where to Shoot in Paris. It is a class on Kelby One, and basically I'm not talking about technique and stuff. I'm just going, hey, there's an elevator here that takes you to a great spot where you can shoot. And I get so many great comments. Somebody even wrote me this week, hey, I watched your Paris class on where to shoot in Paris, and I went to those places, worked out great. I did Rome, I did Paris. I haven't done London yet. And as you can tell, my thing for London would be, well, they don't let you in there. There's no photos allowed in there. The doors are locked. Stay in your hotel. So, no, and you know what? London is an awesome town, and it's great to photograph, but right now a lot of places are very sticky about it. Oh, there it is. Brad's got it. A Photographer's Guide to Paris, or to Paris.
So you got four parts there, roughly 15 minutes apiece.
Yeah, so it's about an hour, and I just basically show you, here's all kinds of different places to go. It's like a whole, basically a tour of places to go. I try to give you some tips and some tricks, some of which I learned from a buddy of mine, Serge Ramelli, who lives in just outside of Paris.
I think, can you watch the first lesson for free? Is that
yeah, you can watch the first lesson for free. Yeah, I think you can watch the first one. It's like a preview. So anyway, go check that out. So Tom M.M., asks, what is that wide angle you use for your football images? So I either use a 16-35, mm-hmm. which is not bad. It's not lens of the year, but it's not bad. And then I use an 11-24. I use a 15mm fisheye. So a lot of it, you're going to see a very, very wide angle. So when I'm shooting the 16-35, it's at 16.
Now, you shoot the game with that, or just like the stadiums?
Like the stadium shots and the shots of the players coming out on the field and all. I'm using a 16 or a 15 fisheye. So it's super wide.
Yeah. And you'll put that on a monopod and do kind of a remote thing?
Yeah, I'll put it on the end of a monopod and stuff like that.
Not a travel photography tip.
Speaking of that, I actually did a tutorial on that. So you may not know this. I'm hoping that you'll find out. I write a column for Digital Camera World in...
They're in Europe, in England.
In England, yes. Right?
They were at the conference, the seminar.
Yeah, they were. All right. So anyway, I write a monthly column. And in there, I did a whole thing on setting up your camera with a remote and all that kind of stuff, and doing it mostly on a monopod. So anyway, but I write whenever... Bless you. Bless you over there. Is that Juan?
That's Juan.
Juan has a horrible cold. No. So anyway, but if you live in the UK and you get Digital Camera World, mm-hmm. please go look at my column. I put a lot of time into it. I've been writing them for them, eight months now? Eight issues?
Yeah,
they come out monthly.
It was about that long that we were over there, and that's when you started, right?
Yeah. So, last year when I was there, I started writing for them. And a great magazine, really, really great magazine, great blog. And so anyway, but I'm in the print magazine, mm-hmm. so go check it out. By the way, if you go to their website, it's digitalcameraworld.com, I believe. That tutorial is actually on there. It actually shows. Now, I'm shooting American football when I do it, but that tutorial is on there. So search for me. So Brad's doing it real quick. And you'll see a picture of me holding a monopod.
Maybe. Possibly.
Well, it's kind of going slow. Keep going. There it is.
Boom.
There it is. Scott Kelby shows how remote camera mounts can help you take more creative photos.
Go Vols.
Go Vols. So anyway, but that's them. Digital Camera World right there. Boom. Great magazine. Great people to work with. So anyway, UF Photography says, Scott, I'm going to Guatemala next year. You're backpacking. I'm thinking about a travel tripod, a carbon fiber one. What's your thoughts about something like this? Is there one that you would recommend? So I switched now. I'm using the tripods from Three Legged Thing. It's the number
Legged.
Three Legged Thing. It looks like leg though, but it's Three Legged Thing. Anyway, they've got some really nice tripods. So I was using a smaller Gitzo, and the Gitzo is really nice. It's a very, very expensive monopod. Tripod. These are about half the price, but they're a little bit larger. They're a little bit bigger. but the sturdiness of them is crazy. So actually, they're so which one?
I don't remember which one you use. It's not good. Well, you have it at home still.
Yeah, I have it at home. But that's what it looks like folded up. See how it folds up nice and small? Right, so it folds up nice and small. And I don't know exactly which one. We'll have to put it in the show notes.
I want to say it might be that one that's out of stock.
Yeah, figures. And that's about right. That's about the... But believe it or not, that price is about half of what the Gitzo is. The Gitzo makes a great one. And the Gitzo's lighter and thinner, but I think... I needed a sturdier one. There was a couple times where I was holding my breath for that. The legs on the bottom of the Gitzo were so thin.
Real skinny.
And I used it for years, so it works fine. But anyway, so now I'm on to the three-leg thing. I've got a couple of their tripods. They were wonderful. I had it with me in London and in Paris. All right. Let me show you a couple more images, and we're going to talk about it. I got a couple more tips here. Here we go. All right. So one of the things that I would recommend to do when you're doing travel photography is to... is try not to take in the whole scene of everything, because a lot of people really do. They try to take in everything. So think about detail shots. So we go to a chocolate store, because I'm with my wife, Calibra. She's a chocolate professional. My daughter is a chocolate professional in training. So these are detail shots from inside the chocolate store. These are shot with the 28-300 Tamron.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look in here... and they're just detail shots. But these stuff, they tell the story of the chocolate shop without... Now, I took a wide shot of the cocktail. I just didn't like it. I didn't show it. But anyway, and this was in the chocolate shop store window. So I just kind of held my camera out and took a shot straight down on it. Like, a you know, it was these are samples and stuff. All right, so I went to the tour, of course, the Eiffel Tower. You got to go there. My kids had seen it. And this is the 11 again. I use the 11 a lot. I you know, you have it on loan. You want to get as much as you can out of it. And so I tried to take something just a little different. It's not like your average, but I didn't break the the cliche mode. It's been done before. But anyway, so that's that one. These are just shots around. This was actually right outside my hotel. You open the door, you walked out the front door, and that's what you're looking
Boom.
At. And then here's some shots around. This was my son's lunch at Les Deux Maggots, which looks like the two maggots. this is right across from a pizza place we ate at. That's the outside of the Opera House. And that's at sunset from the Alexander III Bridge, which is a wonderful view of the Eiffel Tower.
And you know it's the third because there's three lights.
There's more lights. All right, and so, you know what was interesting? They had like a strobist group up there doing a model shoot. Yeah, it's like they were teaching. This is from the top of the Arc de Triomphe. I'd never been up there.
That's nice.
So I took that, thank you, took that shot. And then Galeries Lafayette. This is where, look how sharp that is without sharpening. It's just really sharp.
Indeed.
And so here's a couple more shots.
Did you wait till all the people left to get that shot?
No, there's no waiting for... you know what? I would love to go in there after hours. You know what? You know what I've learned about getting into anywhere after hours? The key is you got to let them know forever in advance, a month in advance. So if you're going in September, you need to contact them now and say I'm going to be. Why do they need 4 weeks? I have no idea. Are they doing a background check on you? No. Anyway. So here we go. Here's another. Look at that place. This is an apartment store.
It's a nice dome.
It's just. Here's where we stay. This is our favorite hotel in Paris.
I've been there.
Hotel de l'Abbaye. I actually taped part of my class sitting on
right
a bench
there.
Right there. And this is the interior
portion.
Yeah. There we go. And then somebody told me on Facebook about the Louis Vuitton. Museum, and it's designed by my favorite American architect, Frank Gehry. And look, there's a little slot there where you have a straight view onto the Eiffel Tower. And it's beautiful. It's in a park. And I love Frank Gehry. Love his stuff. So it was very interesting. The award for the most cliche shot goes to me.
Scott Kelby.
So it's weird. I've been going to France since I was 24. I've never been to what's called the Trocadero area, which is opposite. Everybody goes right to the base of the Eiffel Tower. Right? That's everybody goes right there, and there's a park right in front of it. Well, if you cross the river, you come to this area called the Trocadero. Now, there's a very, very, very popular and famous shot. You see a lot of people posing there. And can I show you? You have to put the camera on me. Okay. It's a building, two like seven-story buildings, and just a flat area just flat, and then it drops off, and there's the Eiffel Tower. It's, you've seen it before. It's very, very popular. In fact, can you look up Trocadero, Paris, and you're going to see the classic picture. You see a lot of fashion shoots done there. A lot of fashion shoots are done there, and wedding shoots and things like that. And I'll show you what it looks like. Yeah, that's a good one. That's kind of the idea. Here's the Trocadero. Unfortunately, this has a lot of tourists there.
It's still loading.
But that's what it looks like. It's still loading.
Eventually.
And if you go through there, Brad, you'll find all kinds of shots. So while I'm showing this next part. Okay, so here's the problem. And I talked about this on my last tour, not on my current tour, but I talked about why it's so important. The very first thing you do in a new city is to go take the 2-hour hop-on, hop-off bus tour, because you're going to find out that place that you wanted to be at dawn in the morning is probably under construction or under restoration. Everything in Europe has some level of under construction. So
it's a very HDR show.
Yeah, let me see if I can. Oh, there, that's a nice one. There we go. Take a look at this on Brad's machine. So that's the kind of the famous shot, right? And you get somebody standing there, the Eiffel Tower in the background. I just never done it before. It's cliche. That's obvious here. I still wanted to do it. My son and I went there at sunset. Now, let me show you what the problem was when my son and I went there at sunset. The problem was this. It was half walled off under construction. Literally half of it was under construction, right?
Couldn't you just do the trick where you shoot it symmetrically and copy one side over to the other side? Okay, I'll just be quiet now.
Yes. Yes, I could have done that, Brad.
But see, you didn't
I wish I had thought of that.
You didn't take me with you, so you didn't have me there to whisper, hey, try this.
I hate you, Brad.
I haven't even seen this picture before, so I just thought of that.
That's so funny. I could have even flipped the Eiffel Tower.
Is this my last week?
This is Brad's last week. All right. So let's see. Johan asks again, Scott, if I go to a particular city like London or Paris, and I want one of the instructors like Glenn or Serge to be my guide, how do I get in contact with them? Oh, you can contact them by Twitter or Facebook. I would
say their website.
Send me $100 and I'll introduce you.
Yeah, or send Pete $100, he'll introduce you. Yeah, go to their website, go to their Twitter or Facebook, and you can contact them there.
See if they're even available. They might not even be available.
I don't think either Serge or Glenn actually make their living as tour guides. But like Serge did a thing with us because we knew him, Matt knew him, and knew him personally, and so he kind of helped us out. And we hired him as a scout for a few days. But it's not. I don't think either Serge or
Glenn
are like. They're not. I don't think they're doing tours. If they know you personally, it's one thing. It's a, you know, friend will take you around. But all right, Sean King, Scott, I'm shooting an MLS game this weekend.
This evening.
Tonight. Oh, this evening, and I'm trying a remote behind the net. Ooh, very nice. Any suggestions on what lens I would use and how to pre-focus it? I think you're going to want to go wide, but you don't want to go too crazy wide. I wouldn't go like 14 or 11 or something. Maybe a 28, and. So the pre-focusing thing is going to be the problem. What I would try to do, and I don't know if you're allowed to do this, because like when I'm photographing the players coming out on the field, I have a buddy stand there. I lock the focus on where I think the player's going
to
be.
And then switch
to manual focus. So what you might have to do is if you can get somebody to go behind the net where the goalie might stand, right, focus on the goalie and switch it to manual. It's a little bit of the roll of the dice because if he dives or something happens,
See, whenever I do a remote, I usually, with a wider lens, you don't have to worry as much about depth of field because it's so wide.
Right.
But just to be safe, I usually set it to like f5.6 instead of 2.8 or 4.
Instead of 2.8. Yeah. The other thing that you might try is, and so my buddy Michael Benford for the Falcons talked me into trying it. It actually works really, really well. Is to, if you have a camera that's got like 51 or 61 points and all, turn them all on. Use autofocus, but turn on every point. Don't do the 9 or 21. Yeah. Turn on that big giant, or if your camera has the big square that just everything's in focus, it actually works pretty well. All right, a couple more things we're going to have to go because I think we're probably over time. Oh,
yep,
yeah, we're over time. All right, so here's a couple more shots real quickly here. This is London. Now we're switching to London in the rain.
Because that's what it does there.
How cool is it that this woman, number one, that she had a red umbrella and stood right where I wanted to. I did not set it up. She just stood there.
You didn't set it up, but you changed the color of the umbrella, didn't you?
I did not change the umbrella. I fixed a little part of the umbrella. There was a part of the umbrella that was kind of bent. I did fix that. I did not change the color. There is something I did change in this image. There was a couple of people walking around, and suddenly, in Photoshop, they were gone. Wasn't 30 people, because I wouldn't have even attempted that, but there was a guy kind of walking to her left, and there was someone walking over to the right, so I removed a few people that were there. It made it much more dramatic than having some just some people. But luckily it was raining. A whole lot of people didn't want to be out in the rain.
True.
But the rest was luck that she just, I mean, seriously, she's right there. Actually, my wife took a picture with her cell phone that I think compositionally wise was actually better. By the way, I did straighten the buildings here. See the building on the left?
Straightened.
It was leaning and it looked weird. Sometimes the lean looks cool. Sometimes it looks bad. I did straighten it here. That's the other little bit of magic I did. Here's, you saw those shots earlier. And then this was the front of St. Paul's Church. I wanted to show this door because what this door is telling you is you're not getting in with a camera. See how the doors are closed? Leave your camera outside. And lastly, I did have to take one of these shots. We did go to the Arc de Triomphe back in Paris and took that shot.
And there's a flag there in case you weren't sure what
country it was. There's a flag right there, just in case you weren't sure where it was. Now, there was another example I wanted to show you. If I can just look at my examples really quickly.
Do you want me to talk about these new classes while you're looking for them?
Yeah, would you please?
All right, so over at Kelby One, we've got a couple new classes for you. First up is The Art of Digital Photography, the inspirational series with John Keatley. Mia McCormick interviews celebrity portrait photographer John Keatley. John has developed a style that is as fun as it is creative, and yet very real. John has photographed celebrities, athletes, and politicians, and his work has appeared in publications ranging from Rolling Stone to Wired. Check it out on KelbyOne.com.
You know, Brad, that was so extemporaneous and right off the top of your head. I was amazed how you did that. It just flows out of you. It's almost like you're reading it. Okay, really quickly, I want to show you just a couple more tips to wrap things up. And we don't really do this very often on the grid.
Right.
We don't really give we talk about photography and it's more of a talk show. But usually when I come back from a trip like this, I do a webcast, like where we really go into detail and we focus on all that other stuff. But
have a lot of time and resources for that.
Yeah, right now before Photoshop World, there's just no time. So I kind of rolled this into that. We didn't do the full weight of it, but okay. So I want to give you a tip because I talked about, I was able to be the last person leaving that hallway, right? And so, if I can get everybody to leave, it makes it really, really easy and fun. The problem is, you can't always be the last person. What if your tour was for 9 a.m.,
just have to yell at everybody, get out of my picture.
Right, no, but I want to show you how to get this picture because I've shown pictures like this and people go, oh my gosh, how did you get everybody out of there? Okay, I didn't, and I didn't use a Photoshop trick. I used a camera trick. So take a look. Take a look at the camera. So here's what I did. I'm standing there in front of a ton of people, right? I'm standing there like this in front of a ton of people. Let's switch back to my computer. Here's what I'm seeing, right, is this. That's what I'm actually seeing. But I wind up with this shot by doing this. Watch, here's what I did. Back on me, there we go. I just tilt the camera up till I don't see anybody's head and take the shot. And I cannot tell you how many people have gone, how did you get that place empty? And all I did was just go right above their heads.
This is much easier than pulling the fire alarm.
It's much easier than pulling the fire alarm or waiting for the woman and begging for one more shot. So you're gonna tip the camera up till you don't see anybody's head, fire the shot, and you get it. All right, so that was one example I wanted. I do that very often. It's very, very handy. Mm-hmm. I also wanted to show you, I'm gonna do a shot that is not an HDR. And I wanted, let's go ahead and do this one, if we will. I'm gonna take it. So what I wanted to show you was, the first part of any shot making it a success is that it's composed well, that it's sharp, that it's crisp. But at that point, if you've got a really good baseline image, you're now free to do artistic expression unless you're a photojournalist, which I am not. So I wanna show you some of the things that I would do to this one image just to wrap things up, all right? So first off, we're not at sunset yet.
Right.
I was 40 minutes before sunset, but it started raining and my wife was like, let's go. And I'm like, we're out of here. We take the stairs down. It's 240 stairs down, whatever. It immediately stops raining. Okay. Anyway. So, I look at the image and I think, well, I don't like the color. It's not late enough in the day to be good. It's not early enough to be better. So I also think it's dark in this street. This street's dark. This courtyard is dark. This street's dark. It's just kind of dark all over. It's very flat looking. It doesn't have a lot of contrast and stuff. So I'm going to start from the top. First thing I'll do is try to make the color, all right, the color better. So let's just go and grab, I'm going to drag the tint slider over to the right to make the color better. I think just moving, look at that. I think just that little move, here's before and after, made it look better. Making it look a little bit later. And if you wanted to, you could drag the temperature over towards yellow. I went a lot towards magenta, but anyway, you slide the slider over. Next is the exposure. The exposure really affects the sky tremendously. And if you want the sky to be darker, there's a couple of different things you can do. You could lower the exposure, or you can go and use this tool right here, the gradient tool. The gradient filter, it's called, I believe. Yes, the graduated filter, sorry. And I'm going to lower the exposure and drag it from top to bottom, and it's going to darken the top of the sky. Look, I'm dragging it out almost like a window shade and bring it down to the horizon line. So I'm able to, once I let go back here and decide if I want it darker, if I want it to have more contrast in the sky, even more color, and I can add in whatever I want. I'm not gonna go too crazy, but that's what I did to get, you know, a little bit better look there. All right, so that's all I'm gonna do in that. Next, I always increase the contrast. Images look kind of flat without it, so I increase the contrast quite a bit. Now, I would say that when I just adjusted the contrast, that now the sky looks a little too dark, so I'm gonna go back up there and say, I went too far, clicked on it, and say, I got a little carried away with the exposure on that sky. There we go, that's a little bit better. Now, let's go back to our basic controls. Let's pull back the highlights. Why would I pull back the highlights? Because it helps the sky. Let's see what it does. Didn't do jack. You know why it's not doing jack?
Because you need to restart again?
No. No, because I've got that gradient in the sky. Can I take out the gradient for a second and show you why it helps? Watch. If I get rid of that gradient, and then I use the highlights, you'll see a much bigger effect. Watch.
Wait, you're on the mask thing. You're not on the overall.
Well, that's probably part of it. Sorry. First time using Lightroom.
It's okay. I'm here for you.
Now let's see if you can see the difference. I'm actually gonna, there we go. See how that affects the sky? That's one of the tricks that I actually talk about that in my seminar now. Pulling the highlights back. In fact, we're not even gonna do that gradient. Let's just pull the highlights back. Looks pretty good. Now, I said we have shadow problems here. Let's open up the shadows. Well, that kind of helped. It's not fully there. Let's increase. Now, I want to increase contrast, so I can drag up the whites and drag down the blacks to increase contrast. We add clarity because we want to bring out detail. And the last thing that I would do here, the sky's kind of looking too bright now, I think. I'm going to lower the overall exposure. The sky's looking too bright. And that made my darker problems here and there even worse.
Uh-huh.
I'm just going to go grab the brush,
uh-huh,
hit new, and make sure I can increase the exposure. Let's add light down this street.
It's illuminated.
Light down this street. It looks terrible now. I'm going to fix it in a second. And light in this courtyard. It looks bad, but we're going to fix it. Because it's just, I just took a stab at what to make it. It's way too bright, right? Way, way, way too bright. So now we just go to exposure and bring it down to something reasonable. All right? And then I guess the last thing I would do is I think it needs a little more contrast. I've never met an image that didn't need more contrast. All right. So I'll show you the before and after real quickly here. From there to there. That's quite a change.
Indeed. But so, you didn't make any, like, major moves.
Yeah, it's just the same sliders over here, you know. Yeah. It's just, but when you, if you start off with the image and it's actually pretty decent, if this image starts well, then you can get creative with it.
Right.
If the image isn't good, a bunch of Lightroom won't help it.
Right.
Throwing a bunch of Lightroom or Photoshop at a bad image just makes it, like, what do they say, a pig with lipstick? It doesn't make
sure.
It's still a pig. All right. Johan asks, I have a tip if you're going to Versailles in Paris. I've been to Versailles. Inside, you may not use flash. Yeah, there are no flash signs everywhere in Versailles, and that makes sense. Wait till there's a group of Japanese people and sneak behind them. They use flash all over the place, and you can sneak a flash picture in too. Okay, Johan. Johan. Okay, first. That's wrong on so many levels, I can't even begin to tell you. Number one, your job is not to why won't they let flash in? Number one, it's distracting to other people.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, it can actually do harm
to the stuff,
to the paintings and things and the art that are in there. So your job is not to annoy other people and
do damage.
And do damage to artwork because Japanese people are doing it.
Doesn't matter what race they are.
It makes no matter what race they are, but that was, he was using that as like a cover. The second part is you shouldn't be using flash indoor to light anything anyway. You should not be in any museum or a church or anything and ever touch your flash. If you touch your flash inside one of those places, I can tell you right now, you're doing it wrong. Do not use flash.
If it's inside a church, there might be lightning coming down on you.
Yeah, especially. No, but I'm just saying as far as photographically, you don't ever want to. Unless you're lighting someone for a portrait, you should never use a flash indoors.
Especially at a concert.
Especially at a concert. You know what's interesting about, this is what's so funny. You're at a concert. You have literally, Brad will tell you, 600 lights, 700 lights. Each light is between 600 watts and 1,000 watts on stage aiming, and you think, I need one more flash. There's just not enough light up there. I need the little tiny flash on my camera to take this shot.
I just want to smack you.
Especially since the stage is way, way over there. Your flash probably goes 8 to 10 feet. You're 50 feet from the stage. Let's fire that flash. You know what that lights? The people's heads in front of you. And it just annoys the crap out of everybody. But look, don't use your flash indoors. Unless you're shooting a portrait and you know what you're doing, don't be shooting like architectural shots and all that stuff with a flash, because we'll find you, we'll get you. All right, was there anything else? Let me see if there's anything else I needed to, want to make sure I got everything covered. One last thing, it has nothing to do with London or Paris. I want to show you the difference a super wide angle lens makes. Take a look on screen. On the left is 24 millimeters. So if you have a 70 to 24, on the right is 11. Look at the difference that wide makes. Wide creates that epicness. I am sitting in the same exact spot when I took both of these shots. That's with the 11 to 24, that's at 11. That 11 is crazy, crazy. Someone says, are you using the live view or the viewfinder? I always use the viewfinder. One of the advantages of using the viewfinder, by the way, is...
Which, that doesn't have a viewfinder.
This doesn't have a viewfinder, but I was just going to show the example. Yeah. It will still work. When you hold a camera out like this in front of you, you have a lot of movement in your arms. Mm-hmm. One of the reasons that you want to get good at using a viewfinder, when you take the camera and you rest it against your head and it's touching here, you are stabilizing the camera. When you take your arms, the first thing they tell you is take your arms and tuck them in against your body, right? That's one thing to help stabilize. When you put the camera, that's the third. That's your human body tripod steadying the camera. You do not want to use live view. You gotta get off that. You'll get better shots looking through the viewfinder. Okay. Anything else we got? We had giveaways and stuff. Where did they go?
Okay, giveaways. To win either of these books or a ticket to one of Scott Kelby's seminars, you can go to KelbyOne.com/contest.
Webcast/contest.
Yeah, contest will get you there. Choose a show of the grid, put your stuff in, tell us what you want to win, give us some feedback, some love, some hate, whatever.
Yeah, don't forget, if I'm giving away also 2 tickets to my seminar in Phoenix. So if you want to go to Phoenix, just write Phoenix Seminar. If you want the Versace book or you want the other book.
Album Moxie,
just write it in the comments there.
And there was actually one more Kelby One class they've already scrolled past that I need to talk about if they want to go back up to it. Keep going. There we go. Edge Code Basics with David LaFontaine. Adobe's Edge Code is a lightweight and efficient HTML editor. Need to tweak a bit of code for your website? Need some help? Edge Code Basics is where you want to start to get up to speed quickly. Check out all these new classes and more at KelbyOne.com.
There you go. Hey, also, we're coming up on Photoshop World in a few weeks. We would love to see you there. We have two new after-hour events that are kind of cool. Yep. One is,
kind
of course,
cool.
Awesome. It's awesome. First up, on August 12th, we've got our big party. We have this big, giant party. It's going to be rock-themed and all. So it's going to be a lot of fun. Hope you come and check that out. But also, on August 12th, you get complimentary admission to Wet Republic's Wet at the Night pool party featuring the Chainsmokers.
DJs. EDM.
There you go.
Dance party.
That's complimentary admission and an expedited line for Photoshop World attendees. The party begins at 10:30, but the very, very next night on August 13th, yeah, you get complimentary admission to Hakkasan Nightclub.
With Tiesto.
With DJ Tiesto, who was like unbelievable. By the way, those are pretty happening.
Yeah.
Like those getting into like, Hakkasan.
Yeah.
Now, I want to give you a preview of what it will be like at Hakkasan. So do this at home. Take your hands and put them over your eyes like this. So the lights are flashing and then. But picture that 1,000 times louder, but full of people gyrating and gesticulating.
And masticating,
thank you. Anyway, we got parties. There's parties that you get all obviously really, really cool stuff too, and that's kind of neat. Go to photoshopworld.com. Learn all about it. Lots of fun stuff. We were supposed to do an e-deal too. We were supposed to give like 40% off on a book.
We don't know what the book is.
We don't know what the book is. Oh, there it is.
Canon Lens.
Canon Lens.
From Snapshots to Great Shots.
Who wrote it?
Jared Foster.
I love Jared Foster. He's a good guy.
So anyway, you get 40% off if you use the code KELBY1 at checkout. And so it's $12. So if you have Canon Lenses, buy one. I bet the 11 to 24 is not even in that book.
Never know.
Because it's brand new. Well, Brad, it's been great to be here with you.
Indeed.
And your little baby camera.
G7X.
Baby camera! No, this is awesome little camera. It's little. It's awesome. Anything else, Pete? Thank you for helping us out in Brad's place.
Yeah, if you can't beat a Photoshop World, are any of it's going to be online?
Oh, Pete just asked an interesting question. If you can't actually attend Photoshop World in Las Vegas coming up August 11th, 12th, and 13th, mm-hmm. I think. If you can't be there on those days, we are streaming the keynote live, correct? We are streaming the opening keynote live.
Awesome.
Adobe will be showing some cool stuff. I'll be doing stuff.
You'll be seeing a goofy movie.
You'll be seeing a very goofy movie.
Not the actual goofy, but it's not like Mickey Mouse and Goofy.
It's not that goofy. Anyway, it'll be a lot of fun. And you'll be able to watch it live at photoshopworld.com. If you follow us on, you know who you should follow? You should follow our Kelby One account, mm-hmm. like on Facebook or Twitter, because you will always know what's going on.
Indeed.
I learn stuff that's going on all the time on there that I had no idea about. I'm like, when did we approve that? Anyway, they do all kinds of contests. The contest that we started the show with is run off there.
Yep.
So go follow us on Twitter and on Facebook. Look for Kelby One. You'll find us, little K, blah, blah. Brad, where can people go learn about not your architectural photography?
Because you're not going to find that anywhere except my Instagram. You can go to bradtakespictures.com if you can't remember bemorevisuals.com.
Or
bradsbeard.com.
We'll redirect you to the same place.
Yes.
Well, everybody, we've had a really great time. I'm going to go to the Apple store now and go get my...
Good luck with that.
Get my phone fixed. I dropped my phone on the concrete
and
the glass shattered.
You know why?
Why?
Because you have a big, heavy phone, not a little lightweight phone.
Hey, they actually make that in a version for guys.
Yeah, and apparently you can handle it.
Burn. Hashtag shots fired. Hey, so take a good look at Brad. It's his last day. Take a good look at him. Can we jump to the other camera? We can't do that without someone like running over there.
No, he's already got the jib and stuff. He's ready to
end this show.
Like, he's already halfway up with it. He's like, we're on the outro.
All right.
ScottKelby.com, Scott Kelby on Twitter.
Sure.
All that fun stuff.
Whatever.
Skelby on Facebook.
Skelby.
All right, let's go. Take it out, Arnaldo.
Take it out, boys.
Get out of here. Bye.
Bye. Look at the jib.
Don't look at the jib. Don't.